Hi, my name is Stephen Haeg with MTS Systems Corporation. Today I'm going to spend some time talking to you about heavy truck durability testing in the laboratory. This is an example we're going to chase truck steering system development. Typical truck steering systems, we see some here. There's a couple of different various designs, steering box designs, and we've got lots of various components and joints and knuckles and things, all part of the steering system. So let's take a look at the quick, fast, simple test first. Here's an example of testing a ball stud for a ball joint. Ball joints go in the suspension between the control arms and the knuckle that they allow steering and vertical motion on the suspension. They're subject to a lot of wear, a lot of dynamic loading, harsh environment. We want to establish basic properties, static characteristics, how strong is it, ultimate strength, fatigue strength. Maybe we want to evaluate notch sensitivity of the shaft, manufacturing effects, grinding, surface profile, things like that. We can greatly time accelerate that test. Maybe we were testing an equivalent of 15 hertz on the road. We can test it at 50 hertz or 100 hertz, be 10 times faster in the laboratory. We can test several specimens per day and get statistically valid data by comparing the results from very similar tests. We support parametric studies. We can change one parameter, maybe a radius or a hardness, and then we can test again and compare directly the difference in life. How do we minimize test time and yet retain damage? Well, a lot of times we're looking for constant amplitude sinusoidal tests. Just pick an amplitude, a mean load, and play it back continuously. Very simple, very straightforward. But we want equivalence damage. So if we've got a time history with a bunch of damage that occurred, this is a strain history, we can put those strains into a range mean rain flow matrix, and we can evaluate the hysteresis loops and the fatigue damage for each cycle. We can compare that damage from our stress life curve here, for example, and calculate the damage that each cycle gives. So that damage then can be summed together. We can apply load to achieve the selected strain level. So we decide what our peak strain needs to be, and then it'll tell us how many cycles will it take to complete the test. And all the tools to do that automatically are contained within RPC Pro. Maybe we want to minimize test time and retain damage, but we want to be more representative of the variable time history. We've got various mean loads here, various amplitudes. So we're going to do a block cycle test. That takes the data and breaks it into different mean loads and different dynamic loads to simulate better the real changing environment of the specimen. In this case, again, we're going to use our range mean rain flow matrix, but we're going to extract not only the range, but also the mean forces as separate bins. We're going to remove the strain ranges below the fatigue limit to edit the data down so we don't have quite so much content. And then we can develop an equivalent block cycle strain history. Gets various mean loads and various cyclic loads together to get the same equivalent damage of this time history data that we started. All of these tools are also available within RPC Pro. Maybe we want a bi-axial test, in this case where tension compression and shear loading simulates a little more realistically the loading environment of the ball stud when it's in real service. We can use loads from a previous design, uniaxial strain field. We can use multiaxial loads, but it's typically a uniaxial strain field. Boundary conditions are not very critical. The ball joint sits in a cup, and we can ground the cup, and that gets a pretty realistic environment. So we can time accelerate this test as well. If we're not slipping and sliding and moving, we can't accelerate slippage, for example. If you go too fast, you might overheat, or you might change the wear characteristics. This is a ball joint seal test. This has got two axes, rotation and rocking, with an environmental chamber here. We can put hot and cold and sands and slurries and salts and things in here and test 10 seals at once, all getting exactly the same excitation. So by putting different materials in here, for example, we can see how the various materials last. Maybe we want to test more than just the stud itself. Maybe we want to test the entire ball joint assembly. Here's an example of a 3-degree of freedom system. It does tension compression and shear load along with rocking and rotating. And then in addition to that, we can put salt spray on here to cause the corrosion effects. This is an example of a 5-degree of freedom ball joint test. In this case, we're testing two ball joints. They have the same motion profile, but they can have separate load profiles. They're really independently arrived there. We've got different actuators to load each of the ball joints. So you could put two different designs in with the same loading, or you can put the same design in with two different sets of loads and compare the results. This is a 6-degree of freedom ball joint test that includes a complete environmental simulation. Hot and cold and slurries can be used. With all 6 degrees of motion and load in here, we get a complete simulation of all the forces and dynamic loads that go into the ball joint system. This system tests 2 ball joints at a time, and they do achieve the same program. Here's an example of a test of a pitman arm. Very common to have these gearboxes down here to push to a pitman arm. So we simulate the load from the arm and the rotation from the steering wheel, and we can test the gearbox. Here we want to look at a little more complete steering system, the steering gear assembly. Here's an example of a Panhard rod load that we're dynamically applying onto a recirculating ball gearbox. Here's a steering wheel input and tie rod end loads in a cyclic kind of a, what I call a A-B comparison sort of test. It's not real-time data, but it allows to repetitively simulate an exact simulation to see a wear case or a fatigue case. We have to separate tension compression from displacement in order to get good control on a test like this. We'll talk about that in a little more detail now. What exactly does that mean? Well, if we think about when we're running a system like this with a ball joint and a tie rod system in here, we can have tension compression and translation. When we have both of those going together, sometimes actuators are pushing in the direction they're traveling, and sometimes they're pulling in the direction they're traveling. That's a different gain situation to deal with in the control loop, and that makes the control very difficult. What MTS does is we do what we call a matrix control, where we sum the data for both the compression and tension and the translation, and we divide that out to command the servo valves so that each actuator understands what it's going to be doing. It's going to be pushing while it's moving or pulling while it's moving, and the control stays nice and uniform, and we maintain good, accurate data content. Oh, and this is one of those things that MTS does that not many other people do, what we call the MTS secret sauce. This is a 5DOF real-time simulation system. In this case, we've got steering wheel input, we've got tie rod loads, vertical dynamic displacement, all in real-time, playing back real data. This is a 5-degree of freedom simulation, including environmental simulation with hot and cold, corrosion, contamination, water effects. We can study performance versus temperature, test the seals and bellows, test for wear, test for fretting. They're so very critical to have the environmental effects there to study those specific things. Maybe we want to look at a full system level test. What happens when we integrate it into the vehicle? This is an example of a full system test for a heavy truck. The truck is put on here, it's loaded, and it's supported by the wheels that are steering. We put the brackets here, and here's the actuator that provide the steer loads. So the truck gets a vertical force. We get steering wheel input here from part of the truck chassis. We provide the dynamic loads here to load the steering system while it's running back and forth, and we get a complete realistic boundary conditions using real truck parts. We can do real-time simulation if we want. It only does the steering and a static vertical. Dynamic vertical could be added, of course, and other degrees of freedom could be loaded as well. We can do simulation of maneuvering, rough road, and parking because fixed reaction means we're not limited by displacements at the low frequencies. We can go very low, like driving into a parking lot, stopping, turning, backing up. All can be simulated with a test like this. That was just one example of many systems we have in the vehicle. We really should go through all of these to do a comprehensive overview, but we're not going to go through that today.